Namaste to Onnandal, and very, very good morning to all the members present. This is the seventh online workshop for vice chancellors, directors, principals, deans, and universal human value coordinators. And this is being, mainly driven by All India Council of Technical Education, under the stewardship of Professor Anil D. Sastri Buddeji. The online workshop or webinar will go for 5 days, starting from today to May 6th. And the main theme of this workshop, as earlier mentioned, incorporating universal human values in technical education. I'm very happy to note that there are more than almost 492 participants. Being a host university, let me thank AICT for giving us an opportunity to involve ourselves and conduct this program for 5 days. As the host university vice chancellor, I wish to welcome Professor Anil D. Sastri Buddeji, the honorable chairman of AICTE, Professor M.P. Puniaji, the Vice Chairman of AICTE, Professor Rajiv Kumarji, the Member Secretary and very active member in this program, AICTE, Professor Unnikrishnan, the Southwest Regional Camp, Dr. Santi Velu, Shakti Velu, the Regional Officer of Southwestern Region, Dr. Neetu Bhagat, the Deputy Director and of IPC AICTE, and we have a coordinator of making this plenary section, etc., Dr. Manish Mishraji with us. And we also have Dr. Rajneesh Aroraji, the chairman of our NCC IP, and also the convener, Dr. Shishir Gaurji from IIT BHU Varanasi, and all the members of NCC and IP. And I also take this opportunity to welcome all the participants. There are about 25 vice chancellors, 47 registrars and directors from various institutes, deans, and more than 130 principals and directors from various institutes, and about 70 VHP and student induction program coordinators, universal human values and SIP coordinators, and all other participants. And as Neetuji pointed out, if there are any family members of the various teachers, they are also welcome. And I think they will be benefited more from this activity.
So we can see that, Anna, in relation, we ensure we want mutual happiness. And while working with the rest of nature, we want mutual prosperity. So ultimately, what is happiness to be understood? So if you explore, you'll see that given any state or situation, wherever you are, if there is harmony or synergy in it, then it is naturally acceptable to you to be in that state or situation, right? So to be in a state of harmony or synergy is happiness. So essentially, if you see, happiness is to be in a state of harmony. So at all the four levels, you can see, like within yourself, if you see, you are sitting with yourself, there is nobody to talk to, and you are thinking something. Now, if there is harmony in your thought, you are at peace, you are happy, you can continue with it. But if there is some contradiction, conflict, anxiety, something in your thoughts, then you want to come out of it. So essentially, at your level, if you see, the harmony in your thoughts is happiness, right? Similarly, when there is when we are living in a family and we are interacting with each other, right? And when there is harmony there, then you feel happy being in the family. Similarly, at the level of society, like today only, I just mentioned that the colony has got sealed because somebody has got infected. Now, this is not the state of harmony. Everybody is locked up in one's own house. Earlier, people were at least going for a stroll in the morning. Now, nobody is coming out. Everybody is fearing. So, there is fear outside. What can happen anytime? Today, one family is infected. Tomorrow, 10 families can get infected. Now, this kind of state is disharmony, right? But when it is not there, people are able to relate to each other. And these kind of situations are also not there. So this kind of a state of harmony gives us happiness. Similarly, with the rest of nature, right? So whatever state or situation we are in, when there is harmony in it, we feel happy. And this is something that we would like to continue with. On the other hand, if you see like any state or situation when there is disharmony or contradiction, right, or some opposition, then it is not acceptable to us naturally to be in that state, and we want to come out of it. Whenever there is some disharmony, you want to come out of it, right? So for example, you are sitting by yourself and you have some turmoil in your thoughts and you want to come out of it. So what you do, you generally switch on the TV or turn up something in the mobile, right, and do so many things so that you can come out of it. So this is something which we don't want to continue with, this state of contradiction, this state of disharmony. But still, if you are forced to be in that state of disharmony, this becomes unhappiness. So we can see, where do you want to be? Whether you want to be in the state of harmony or whether you want to be in a state of disharmony, right? So anytime when there is disharmony, we try to come out of it. When there is disharmony in the family, right? Some quarrel is going on, you try to come out of the house, you know? When there is disharmony in the department, you try to move out of the department, go somewhere, have some tea or coffee, right? So whenever there is some disharmony, we try to come out of it. We don't want to continue with it, simply. So the state in which I want to continue is something that is naturally acceptable to me, and that is the state of harmony, right? And that is the state of happiness. The state in which I do not want to continue in disharmony is unhappiness. So a very simple thing to find out for oneself. So try to locate within yourself at the level of natural acceptance, what is that state in which you want to continue, right? Now here I'd like to mention that happiness and excitement are two different things. So many a times it so happens, no, that we assume excitement to be happy. For example, we work on 5 days in a week, right? Many times 6 days in a week. And if you look at the work, most of the time we are interacting with human beings. We are not even toiling in the sun so that our body gets tired. But by the evening, we get totally fagged up, totally tired, right? On the weekend, we plan to go outside, dine with the family outside in some restaurant, watch movie, and do some merrymaking. Why is all that required? Because we are not happy doing what we are doing. So maybe we are working a lot, but we are not working in a state of harmony. That's why we want to come out of it. We wait for the weekend, we wait for the merrymaking time. And there also, if you see, when we are doing something for merrymaking, we cannot continue with it. You watch a movie, and the next time if you have to see the same movie, you feel bored. So if you look at our state of living, most of the time we are in disharmony, and we are planning to come out of disharmony. So what is essentially required is a transformation from this escape route from disharmony to the state of harmony. So let me take some more examples. For example, you watch a cricket match, and there is a team that you belong to. And when that team wins, you feel excited, right? And what happens when the team loses? You feel depressed, you feel unhappy. So you cannot continue. There is no continuity in that winning or losing, right? If the same team keeps on winning every time, you don't feel again excited because you know that it is going to win again. Say the bowler is throwing a ball and the person holding the bat gets out, right? And you again feel excited, you feel thrilled. And what happens if the umpire says that that was a no ball? Again, your thrilling goes away, your excitement goes away. So many a times, if you see yourself closely, you'll find that we are in a state of disharmony and we are trying to come out of disharmony through excitements. And many a times you'll see, let me be a little more explicit here, and that for that you have to be more sincere in your exploration. You can find out that it may be the case that we are not in a state of harmony at all. We are just in a state of disharmony and planning to come out of disharmony time and again through these measures, through exciting moments, through thrills, through enjoyments, through merrymaking. And this has become the state of our life, isn't it? So let us be clear what happiness is. Let us be clear what unhappiness is. So that, because now whatever we are going to discuss will be an elaboration over happiness. So when we are able to see that happiness is the state of harmony, right, then only we can start exploring what harmony would mean at the level of individual, what harmony would mean at the level of family, society, and so on and so forth. I'll share one example what excitement means. So it so happened that there was a professor, and in his house, a maid used to come and the husband of the maid used to play lottery. All of us probably know, hai na? And once he won rupees 1 crore in the lottery. So the maid, and the news came to the maid, and the husband was not at home at that time. So the maid thought that if I tell this news to my husband directly, then he will feel so excited that he will get a heart attack, because he was little frail, little weak, not so healthy. So she thought that I should go to some learned person, and then ask him to share this particular thing to my husband. So she, in the evening, asked her husband to go and meet the professor. So this person went and met the professor. So the professor, she had explained the whole thing to the professor. The professor slowly started explaining things to him. So he said that, okay, let us say you get 10 rupee note somewhere. What will you do? Then he said that, okay, I'll take some tea out of, I'll use it for tea. Then he said that, okay, you get a 100 rupee note. Then he said that I'll have a good lunch. Let's say you get a 1,000 rupee note, and so on. And I kept on proceeding like that. And he kept on giving his plans, the husband of the maid. Then he said, suppose one day you get 1 crore rupees, what will you do? Right? Then the husband said that, what will I do? This is a too big amount. I'll give half to you. And this professor had a heart attack now. So this is the meaning of excitement. So we need to distinguish between excitement and happiness. So we have to see, what harmony is, what happiness is, right? And we have to distinguish between escaping from disharmony and being in harmony. These may be two different things. So to escape from disharmony, we keep on using so many things. And many a times we term that as happiness, but that may not be happiness. So a simple clue here is the state in which you can continue, you would like to continue, is happiness. The state in which you cannot continue cannot be happiness. So you cannot continue the state of excitement, isn't it? And cannot be universal also. So the takeaway from here is happiness is to be in a state of harmony, and unhappiness is to be forced to be in a state of contradiction. Right? If there are any questions, there could be so many questions arising out of it. So the more we explore into this, things may become clear. Otherwise, we can discuss in detail in the evening about happiness and unhappiness. The second thing that we have been talking about since yesterday is prosperity. What is prosperity? So the prosperity is the feeling of having more than required physical facility. So when I'm able to see that, the physical facility that I have, are more than required. For example, I need food for the body, and I have more than required food in my family, right, in the house. Clothes that I have are more than required. The shelter that I have are more than required. So if I'm able to make out that the physical facility which I have already are more than required, I feel prosperous. Right? On the other hand, if I do not see that I have more than required, then I feel deprived. So let me ask you one question. We had given you one assignment yesterday that you have to count your clothes. So let me ask, how many of you have counted your clothes? So yesterday a task was given to you that you had to count your clothes. So in the meantime, I think I can take one or two questions from people who have not so far discussed. So Dr. Swaminathan, do you have any question regarding the content that we are discussing right now, sir? Dr. Kumaraswamy?
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
So the content what we are discussing is highly useful. And it is all based on the theory of the mind. Mm-hmm. What the mind looks into the understanding, what the mind looks into the prosperity, what the mind wants is happiness. So ultimately, everyone want to be happy.
Mm-hmm.
So when we start up in the morning, we get up in the morning thinking about the duties.
Mm-hmm.
And about the, we have to go to office, we have to attend to the duties. There is a sense of duty. Other than that, I want to be happy today. Mm-hmm. I get up because of I need happiness. So happiness is a result of what we do every day. So my question is, the something, how to achieve the skills of life skills we are talking about. So is there any method? People talk about the meditation, other thing. So is there any method to cultivate the skill of this understanding and getting happiness? And so is there any mind training? People, yogis and other people are talking about meditation. So can you suggest some method wherein which daily we practice so that we will be happy and we will balance the life and work?
So first of all, sir, there is no skill required for this. There is no technique required for this. Essentially, what is required is something that we discussed right now, to look at the proposals and verify them at the level of your natural acceptance and then live accordingly to validate in your relationship with human being and the rest of nature. So that is basic requirement. You know, so the techniques, that whatever techniques you employ, you know, they may not be universal. So techniques can be left to you. You know, you can utilize whatever technique appeals to you. Essentially, what is required to be done is this process of self-exploration. Hello.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
I'm hearing.
And second thing, sir, we are doing our duties daily in the college, you know, or in the institution, right? We may not be happy doing those tasks, because maybe that those duties may not, we are not able to see that those duties are in conformity, you know, to our natural acceptance. So that is again another thing to explore. So can we be happy doing our, you know, official work? Can we be happy doing our household chores?
Okay.
So this is something to be explored. If not, then we have to spare time for happiness, and then we have to sit in one place and do so many things, right? Otherwise, we can be happy every moment.
Okay.
If I'm able to explore within myself naturally, you know, and I'm able to decide my behavior, my participation, my role, wherever I am, either in the family or in the institution, on the basis of right understanding, I can be happy doing everything, you know, what I'm assigned to.
Yes.
So that is something to be explored. That is something to be understood.
Yes. Sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, sir. So nice. So 184 people have said that they have counted their crores. Very nice. It's a good achievement. So through that, I think many of you might have been able to see that you have much more than required. You know? In terms of crores, you can see that you have much more than required. Right. So you can see that if you do not explore into this, even if we have so many crores, we do not feel prosperous. But the moment we start exploring, you know, we feel feel prosperous. And a simple exploration, a simple evaluation for a limited time makes us prosperous, while the effort that we keep on doing, earning, you know, physical facilities and then investing them and doing all those things without clarity of the needs, does not let us feel prosperous. So to feel prosperous, the right understanding of the requirement for need for physical facility is required. So this is something that we are going to, you know, discuss now. How to understand that. So to sum up for this, so basic human aspiration is continuous happiness and prosperity, and happiness is to be in a state of harmony. Prosperity is the feeling of having more than required physical facility, right? But we'll elaborate more on this feeling of prosperity today only in the second session. So now we'll start exploring the harmony at each level. So to start with, we'll talk about harmony in the human being. And when we say human being, there are two realities to be addressed. One is the body, you know, which we are very much aware. There is another reality that is termed as self, you know, what in general what we call as I, you know. So I am happy, I am unhappy, I am feeling bored, I am feeling excited, I want to do this, I don't want to do this. We keep on using this word I, and this is the most commonly word used in a day by every human being, right? So can I understand myself? Can I understand the needs of I? Can I understand the activities of I? Can I understand the responses of I? And can I distinguish between I and body, self and body? So this is something that we are going to explore, right? And this is very much a content which can be a part of education. There is nothing ambiguous, or there is nothing which cannot be explored here. You know? We'll see as we go along. So this can be understood very clearly. And the process will be the same, right? Taking things at the level of proposal and then verifying and validating. So as we discussed, so human being is coexistence of two realities. One is the body and the other is self. And coexistence means that both are existing. Body is also existing. I am also existing. And we are coexisting, right? I am fulfilling the needs of my body. The body is fulfilling my needs, right? And we are interacting, right? So we are coexisting. Now we'll try to explore further. So one thing that we can find out is the need of the self and the need of the body. And we can see that my need is happiness. The need of the body is physical facility. So happiness would mean something which is naturally acceptable to me. For example, respect, trust, these feelings in relationship, which are acceptable to us naturally. These feelings give us happiness, right? While here, if you see, for physical facility, we need things like food, clothes, shelter. Now, whatever I need in terms of physical facility is temporary. I need it from time to time, right? So I need food thrice a day, water so many times a day. In winter, I need winter clothes. In summer, I need summer clothes. I do not want a quilt in summer, and I do not want something which I keep on using in the summers, in winter. So they are needed from time to time, occasionally, right? But here, if you see the needs of the self, they are all continuous. Whatever is naturally acceptable to me, I want it in continuity. So like feeling of respect, I accept it very naturally. I want to have the feeling of respect. And you see, want to have the feeling of respect all the time, every moment. We can see that you want to have this feeling of respect while sleeping also. So every need which I have for myself, I need it in continuity. While here, if you see the needs of the body, they're all temporary. For example, you are going to sleep and you murmur, you listen somebody murmuring in the house that it's good that this person is going to sleep. Whole day he creates a commotion in the family. And just think what will happen to you now. You have heard of these words, right? And when you go to sleep, you are not able to sleep well because the feeling of respect was not conveyed to you, right? The child is going to sleep and the wife and the mother says that you can't sleep with me today, you're not a good boy. And then just see what will happen to the child. So this is something that we require every moment. Try to find out any need of yourself, which is only occasional, and try to find out any need of the body, which is continuous. So you'll see that my needs are continuous. The needs of the body are all temporary. Even if you look at air, which my body keeps on inhaling, right? You also see that we inhale at one point of time and then exhale. We cannot keep on inhaling in continuity. We cannot keep on exhaling in continuity also. But here, if you see these feelings, we want to continue with them. And these all feelings are qualitative, right? So we cannot quantify them. We cannot say that I want 1 meter of respect, 2 kg of trust, 3 ounces of affection. We cannot talk like this, appears humorous. So whatever feeling is naturally acceptable to me, I want it, and this is something qualitative, cannot be quantified. On the other hand, if you see, when you talk about physical facility, they are all quantitative. When you talk about quality also, in terms of physical facility, it is related to the quantity. For example, the quality of food is related to the quantity of ingredients, isn't it? So again, there, if you see, in terms of physical facility, whatever we require for the body is all quantitative. And you can also see that they are all limited in quantity. For example, food, that is limited in quantity. You can make out how much food you will consume in a month, in a year. And that's how we make the budget. How much food we are going to consume in the year for the whole nation, right? So everything which we require for the body is quantitative. Food, clothes, shelter. Now the number of houses that you require. The number of rooms that you require in your house. You try to think about it. Just try to make out whether whatever you require in terms of physical facility, can it ever be unlimited? Can you eat unlimited food? For example, you go to the house of your in-laws and you are fed, right? And people keep on coming and serving to you that, okay, you have come after such a long time, you take one more idli, take one more dosa, right? You can accept up to a limit, but not beyond that limit. After a certain limit, there's going to be some disharmony in the relationship, right? Because you're being forced to eat while you do not want to eat. So whatever we consume at the level of body, for the body, is all quantitative and is all limited in quantity. We may keep on accumulating more and more, right? But ultimately, that may not be a need. So there is one person who was caught on the charges of corruption in NCR. And when he was charged with corruption, this person had 1,000 houses, right? And just think, how many houses does a family require? One house would be enough. And in that also, how many rooms do we require? Do we need hundreds of rooms? Or we can have, two or three rooms, and that can suffice. And there also, even if you have hundreds of rooms, it is limited. 100 is less than 1,000. 1,000 is less than 1 lakh. So whatever we require in terms of physical facility is limited in quantity. Try to think over it. We may keep on imagining about accumulating unlimited wealth, unlimited physical facility. But ultimately, we'll see that whatever we have in terms of physical facility can only suffice for the body. It cannot suffice for me. The physical facility can never serve my need, right? Because it is something needed for the body. As a human being, I require both. As a human being, I require respect as well as food. Let us say you met a friend of yours in the market outside, and he was an old friend of yours. He takes you to his house and then serves you very delicious and good food, lot of variety, right? And you eat all those delicious variety of food. And the moment you are finished, this person says that you would never have been able to get such quality of food. Next time, whenever you like to eat, come to my house. Now just think what will happen to you now. Your body is satiated, your body is full with the food, right? But what you got is disrespect. Now just think, will you ever plan to go to his house again, right? So your body got enough food, body has no problem with the words that the other person spoke, but you got hurt because the food that was served, you found out that it was not served with respect. I was treated as servile. I was treated with disrespect. So as a human being, we require both. In a similar manner, you go to somebody's house and he treats you quite fondly, keeps on chatting with you for hours together, right? But he does not ask for water, does not ask for tea, does not ask for food, then what will happen? There also it will not suffice. Then you will plan of coming out so that you can have something to eat. So as a human being, we require both respect as well as food. But we need to make out what is needed where. So you can see that food is needed for the body and respect is needed for the self. But again, in the second case also, if the person is treating you so fondly with so much of respect, so when there is that feeling of relationship, you can simply ask the person to get some tea for you or some water for you. Or you can go yourself to the kitchen and have some water or start preparing tea when there is a feeling of relationship involved. So you can see what holds the higher priority for us. If somebody is giving food but not respect, then what would occur to you? And when somebody is giving respect but not food, then you can of course share with the other that you need food also. So first of all, find out whether these needs are of different type or of the same type. Let us look at this. What do you think? These needs are same type or different type? So in the meantime, I can take up some questions. Some hands are raised. Dr. Gopalakrishnan? If you have any question regarding this, I think I can start from the bottom.
Can you hear me, sir? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, actually, the happiness depends on the person to person. Is it correct, sir?
I'm not saying that, sir. First of all, let us look at this. Who needs happiness, self or body?
Happiness, sir. Body.
Body needs happiness or self needs happiness? You need happiness self, or your self, body needs?
Yeah, self needs.
Self needs, yeah. So can you distinguish between happiness and physical facility?
Not physical facility, sir.
Yeah. So can you distinguish between happiness and physical facility?
In the happiness depends upon the mindset, but mm-hmm. is not able to discuss about the physical facility with the body.
That is something that we are going to discuss now. How is that going to be ensured? And how is happiness going to be ensured? Right. And next, we'll also discuss how whether this happiness can be universal. And see, if happiness, the meaning of happiness is not universal, then you can never ensure mutual happiness and continuity. Because happiness for you, if it is not the same as happiness for the other, you cannot live together. And that is what is happening. We have preconceived notions about happiness. We'll discuss about this, right? And we have not even verified that whether this is happiness or not. And as I mentioned, many times we treat excitement as happiness, right? We treat some sensation as happiness. And then we can see that, you know, there's a lot of variation across the world. So we have to understand, you know, if the meaning of happiness is so not
happiness, happiness depends on the varies from person to person.
I'm not saying that, sir. Please wait a minute. We'll discuss this further. I'm not saying this. Presently, what we are addressing is the needs of self and body. If you have anything to share on this, sir, please go ahead. Otherwise, please wait for some more discussion, sir. Then this will become clear automatically, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Everything is going on very well, sir. Thank you for your...
Nice, sir. Okay. So most of you are able to see that they are different. Okay. Even if it appears similar, no, please explore it further. You know? You can see that physical facility is something of one kind. And you know, happiness or respect or trust, these things are something of another kind. Right? And again, find out whether both of these are important and we want to fulfill both of them, or we can drop one of them, right? So certainly we want to fulfill both of them. We cannot drop the need of body. Otherwise, how can we even discuss with each other? We do not have the breakfast, lunch, dinner. How can we even interact with each other? And are we working to fulfill both types of needs? And what is the priority between the needs of the self and needs of the body? So try to find out what is the priority. So we can see that we have invested 1/3 or 1/4 of our life getting educated, right? Why? So that we can fulfill the need for physical facility with respect. Otherwise, the need for physical facility can be fulfilled in so many ways. Somebody can even throw food at you and your stomach will get full. But if you're not treated with respect, that is not acceptable to you. So as a human being, we do so much. You know? We try to get educated. We educate our family. We invest for our family so that everybody is able to ensure a respectable life. Why that much we are doing? Because the needs of the self hold a higher priority. Next thing we can see, how is it going to be fulfilled? So if you look at the needs of the body, they are going to be fulfilled by physiochemical things. Right? So all the physiochemical things. Physiochemical would mean something physical or something chemical. So food, if you look at it, you know, it is a physiochemical thing. Your clothes is a physiochemical thing. All the gadgets that you are using are physiochemical things. You know, the whole house is filled up with physiochemical things, right? So the needs of the body are going to be fulfilled by physiochemical things. But when you look at your needs, right, your needs are fulfilled by right understanding and right feeling. So when you have the right understanding in you, then you are happy within. When you have the right feeling in you, then you are able to relate rightly to the other and you are happy in your relationships. When you miss these, then you know, you are unhappy within. Let's say you are sitting in your room and your room has a split AC, which is running at 18 degrees Celsius in this summer. And you are lounging on a sofa, which is quite a modern type, you know, so comfortable, right? And everything in the house, you know, is like so luxurious. In the same room with those many physical facilities, you are sitting with someone with whom you have a feeling of opposition. Now what will happen? Will you feel happy or unhappy? The body has all those physical facilities, right? But you are not able to have the feeling of relationship with the other. Will you feel happy or not? Certainly not. You know? You would wait for the other person to leave. Now let us say the other person is also not there. The AC is running at the same 18 degrees Celsius. Right, you are lounging in your sofa, the other person is not there, but you are still thinking of the other person. the conduct of the other person, right? So what is happening with you again? The body has all the physical facilities, but you are not at peace because you are not having the right feeling about the other. You are not able to, you know, have the happiness in relationship with the other. So you can see that our happiness, you know, or the happiness of the self is not going to be ensured by physiochemical things. It is something to do with right understanding and right feeling, right? So again, explore it. So the needs of the body cannot be fulfilled by right understanding, right feeling alone. The needs of the self cannot be fulfilled by physiochemical things. The two are quite different. So the needs, if you look at them, they are different. The way of their fulfillment is also different. For example, this workshop that we are conducting, you know, it is to address the need of the self. And we took so many examples earlier also that in a family, most of the problem that we are facing today is not due to lack of physical facility. It is due to the lack of feeling in relationship. And that feeling in relationship is something to do with the self, right? So both the types of needs have to be understood separately and both the types of needs have to be fulfilled separately. Now in living, what is the priority? How much time and effort is spent for right understanding, right feeling? How much time and effort is spent for physical facility? So we'll again have your reflection on this. So one thing I would like to make it clear. So having priority for right understanding, right feeling would mean that we are investing time to ensure right understanding in us, right feeling in us. We are investing, you know, our own efforts to ensure the right understanding. So do we have a schedule in a day that so much time at least I'm going to invest for right understanding in me so that I'm able to ensure happiness in me? Or most of the time I'm spending for physical facility, or in fact all the time I'm spending for physical facility, though I am sometimes, you know, groaning inside, I'm unhappy within, I'm anxious within, I'm having grudges within, but still I keep on working for physical facility. So that is something that we have to explore. So let me, you know, ask that question. So both these needs are to be fulfilled. In living, what is the priority? How do you spend most of the time and effort in a given day over a week? Do you spend your time and effort, you know, working for right understanding? Again, let me again reiterate, right? Working for right understanding means we are exclusively spending time for right understanding to understand the things as they are, to ensure the right feelings in us. The other option could be that we are just working, you know, from 9 to 5 or 10 to 6, right, in a day, 6 days a week, and then earning physical facility, right, and then spending that physical facility on the weekend here and there. So if that is the shape of life, then certainly we are investing time and effort for physical facility. In the meantime, if there is any question, I'll take that question. So Dr. Govindan.
Yeah. Good morning, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have understood that body itself, right, is a physical facility. Everything which we give in a physical aspect will gain the physical body. And I want to know, what is the self? Can you please describe the self? Is that a mind?
In the next session, we'll describe the self.
Okay, yes. Yes.
So once we are able to see that there are two realities.
Yes.
And they are not the same. Self is there, body is there.
Yeah.
Then investigate further to understand the self.
Mm-hmm.
So at this moment, what we are trying to do, we are trying to explore the existence of two distinct realities. One mm-hmm. being body, another being the self.
That yes.
That is something that we term as I.
Uh-huh.
And this is very, very basic. Unless we understand the two realities differently and distinctly, we are not able to make the right program for the two also.
Yes, I understood. Yes. Can you please define what is self?
Certainly, sir. In the second session, we'll uh-huh. discuss about the self in detail.
Yeah, okay, sir. And from yesterday, yes. I have categorized something called human values, right? Can you please characterize that, the human values?
Yeah, we saw that human values are those which are universal, which are naturally acceptable, which we can verify within, you know, which are very much innate, invariant, right? They don't change with time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and something that lead to harmony.
Okay. So I just gained something from yesterday. yes. I myself categorized something which is called love, bliss.
Okay, sir. Okay, what we'll do, sir, right now, the question that I'm taking is pertaining to the content proposed here. You come up with these questions in the evening, sir, we'll certainly discuss.
Sure, I will.
We'll discuss further tomorrow.
Yes. Sure.
Talk about all those values in the relationship.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, so many of you are saying that you're spending your time and effort for writing, standing rightfully. Very nice. In fact, this lockdown has given us ample time also. Let me say that we are seeing a different kind of result in the reflections nowadays. And that is something to be thanked for, this lockdown. This lockdown has given us ample time for us to reflect upon ourselves, introspect. But a good thing is there. Yes, so if you are spending time and effort for writing, standing right, feeling very good. But again, you have to understand what would this effort mean, right? Are we saying this knowingly or unknowingly? So this is something to be again explored. And if I am spending most of my time and effort for physical facilities, certainly I have to make a different kind of plan for myself. Next thing that we can observe is the activity. So when you look at the activity, you can see that in the body there are certain activities like eating, walking, these activities are there. When you look at the self, you can see that you have certain different kinds of activities. You have desires in you, you have thoughts in you, you have expectations in you, right? And these are completely different from the activities like eating, walking, or any other physical activity that we do, right? So these activities, you can see that they are temporary. All the activities of the body, you can see that they are all temporary, right? To be more precise, you can see that this breathing also, you are inhaling and you are exhaling. Neither inhaling is continuous nor exhaling is continuous, right? Whatever you see in the body as an activity, crossly if you see, whatever is happening in the body is a combination of two different activities, expansion and contraction. Your heartbeat, your pulsation, the blood running in the stream, the veins, all these things, if you see, they are just active by virtue of expansion and contraction. And neither expansion is continuous nor contraction is continuous. So whatever is happening inside the body is temporary. If you look at the self, whatever is there is continuous. So your desires may keep on varying from time to time, but the activity of desire is very much there in you. You may thought of different kinds of things in a day, but the activity of thought is there in you all the moment, even while sleeping. You can see that these activities are there even while sleeping. Who has dreams, self or body? Certainly the self, right? And that dream, what is happening there? It is again some combination of desire, thought and expectation. So you can see that activities of the self are all continuous. Activities of the body are all temporary. Another thing you can see is the response. If you look at the response of the body, it is only recognizing and fulfilling. So you are sitting in your house and you feel hot, right? You get some sensation. So right when you turn on the fan or AC, then you have a different kind of sensation coming to you. So if you look at the body, what is happening there? When it is hot, it is like perspiring, pasina aata hai, right? And when it is not hot, then a different kind of response is there. So the response of the body is simply like recognizing and fulfilling. When you look at the response of the self, you can see that there is also an activity of assuming. So within the self, we are recognizing and fulfilling and also assuming. Let me take an example to distinguish between the two. For example, if a sharp needle is there and it is pricked in the body, what will happen? The needle is sharp and the blood will come out. As simple as this. If the needle is blunt, it will not go inside the body. If the needle is sharp, it will go inside the body. The moment it goes inside the body, blood will come out. As simple as this. So what is happening inside the body is only recognition and fulfillment. Depending on the sharpness of the needle, it allows or disallows. That's all. Now when you look at the self, and somebody is coming to you with the needle and trying to pierce you in your body, will you allow or not? Certainly not. Why will you allow somebody to pierce the needle in your body? But if you are told that, no, this is not a needle, this is syringe and it carries some medicine and can cure you of this particular disease, then you allow. Now, what has happened here? The body will have the same response. If it was sharp, the syringe was sharp, it will go inside the body, you know, and blood would come out, or you know, the this thing will go in, the medicine would go inside the body. So one kind of response is there completely in the body, which is completely definite, just recognition and fulfillment. Whether you allow or disallow depends on your assumption. Now, so somebody, you know, comes and tells you that this doctor is a, you know, quack and he has killed so many people, right? And your life is now at risk. Then what will you do? Allow or disallow? Now we'll disallow. Now what has happened here? Simply your assumption has changed. Earlier you assumed that this is a needle, so you're not allowing. Then you assume that this is a syringe and this person is a doctor and he can cure you, so you allow. Next time you are told that, you know, this is a quack and he has killed so many people, so you don't allow. And then somebody says that, oh, don't go by the other person's words. He's a mad person. He keeps on spreading rumors. This person is a doctor and a well-qualified doctor. You again allow. You can see the response of the self. It is completely determined by your assumption, isn't it? While in the body, there is nothing like assuming. Another activity is there in the self, which is called as knowing. So what we are trying to do, you know, in this workshop, we are trying to know the reality. So we may have so many assumptions about happiness, about prosperity, about life, about peace, about relationship, about our profession, about career. We may have so many assumptions. But what we are trying to do through this exploration, we are trying to know the things as they are. We are trying to know what happiness is. So just now, sir asked what self is. So knowing the self, knowing the body, knowing the coexistence of self and body, right, through this verification process, knowing happiness, knowing prosperity, this is another potential in the self. This is another activity in the self. So once I have the knowing, this assuming, you know, becomes a kind of accepting or acceptance in me, right? So there are four responses in the self and only two responses in the body. So when you look at these four activities, you can see that the recognition and fulfillment of the body is definite, you know, as we discussed. The recognition and fulfillment of the self is on the basis of knowing and assuming. So if the assumption is based on knowing, the assumption is right. And the recognition and fulfillment is also correct. And that leads to definite conduct. So definite conduct means my feelings are definite. For example, if I understand, if I know what respect is, every moment I have a feeling of respect for the other. If I do not understand, my feeling keeps on fluctuating. Sometimes respect, sometimes disrespect. And then my conduct is indefinite. I treat the same person with respect sometimes and sometimes with disrespect. You can see in a family, you know, the mother becomes happy with the child and she will treat the child one way. She becomes unhappy with the child and treats some other way, right? So this is indefiniteness of conduct. So definiteness of conduct would mean that when my assumption is based on knowing, I'm able to know what happiness is, why I'm able to know what relationship is, I'm able to know what nature is, then my interaction with each and every unit becomes definite. And that is definiteness of conduct. When the assumption is without knowing, the assumption may or may not be right. And so the recognition and fulfillment is uncertain. And this is indefinite conduct. Right? And this is written in red because this is not desirable. But we can see that with lack of right understanding, lack of right feelings in relationship, and working only for physical facility, we have indefinite conduct. Right? And this is the problem that we are facing in the relationships, in the society. Right? So when you go to understand these four, so knowing is to see the reality as it is, in its completeness by direct observation, and it is definite, has continuity and universality. While this assuming, you know, if you see, it is acceptance of the reality. So when I know the reality as it is, right? Reality means something which is there, isn't it? I know what family means. I know what harmony in the family means. Then I accept it as it is. And then the acceptance can be based on, you know, on the basis of knowing or even without. This acceptance, if you see, like when it is assuming, it can be, you know, without knowing also, as we mentioned. So when I have this knowing ensured in me, then my assuming is definite, you know, and it takes the shape of acceptance. But when I am not able to know the reality, then my assuming, you know, can vary from time to time, place to place, moment to moment, right? And this is indefinite. And recognizing, if you see, it is to recognize the relationship either with human being or the rest of nature. And fulfilling is to act accordingly with human being or the rest of nature. Now, the issue to explore is that when I am only working in the domain of assuming, you know, recognizing and fulfilling, then this is domain of problem. So we are in problem because we are not able to know the things as they are. right? And then we are preconditioned. We have borrowed notions from books, from people, from family, from surroundings, right? We have so many preconceived notions. For example, a preconceived notion today, now we can see in the experience is money is everything. Now this is a preconceived notion, money is everything. They're not even explored. They don't even know what money can ensure and what money cannot ensure. But this can become a notion. Similarly, they struggle for survival and only the fittest can survive. If you do not understand relationship, you know, somebody said something studying the rest of nature and we assumed it for the human being. Now this is a common assumption, you know, struggle for survival. There can be no education without competition. So many assumptions are there, right? And when we assume without knowing, then assumptions keep on changing from time to time, right? And then the conduct is indefinite. And then we are dependent. Then we are patanta because something else is dictating us. Some statement in the book is dictating us. You know? Some message on the YouTube is dictating us. For example, today we have one choice of clothes and you see something on the YouTube and your choice changes. You see something on the ad in the television and your choice changes. So what is happening? The conduct is indefinite. I'll take an example. We have one center at Kanpur where we have been doing this foundational work and we have been working there for the past 20 years. So one boy from Kanpur, one village in the district of Kanpur came to meet us. And when that boy came, he was in complete stress. So we asked, what is the issue? So he said that he wants our help so that he can study. So we said that, okay, studying is a good thing, but what is your purpose of study? Why do you want to study? Because he had an intense desire to study. So he said that he wants to be richer than his maternal uncle. Now this was surprising to us. How can this person have this kind of desire? So the whole story that he narrated, you know, made it more clear. He said that sometime back, his father died and his maternal uncle lived in the city while they were living in a village. So his mother said that you go and take the help of your uncle. And this boy had two elder sisters who were, you know, who had to be married. And this boy also did not have a job. Her mother was expecting that the maternal uncle would help at this moment of time. So he went to his maternal uncle, but this person did not treat him with respect. In fact, he made him stand at the gate and treated him in a humiliating manner and asked him to leave even without offering water. And this insulted him so much that it completely occupied his thoughts. And he thought that today I am worse, so I have been humiliated. Tomorrow I will become rich. And when I become rich, then I will insult this person the same way as he had insulted me. And with that thought, he came to us and, you know, sought help. So he said that, see, going for studies is a good idea, but this kind of desire can be self-defeating. For example, you pursue your studies, you get a job, you earn also, but let us say you are not able to earn as much as your uncle is earning, right? Then you are never able to humiliate him the same way as he humiliated you, as he insulted you. Then what will happen to you? Then ultimately your whole life is gone, you know, unnecessarily. The whole life you are in stress, and at the end of it also you are in stress because you could not meet your goal. The second possibility is that, you know, you pursued your studies, got a job, earned wealth, but the moment you went to insult your maternal uncle, you know, he found that he is no more. You know, by that time he has expired. Again, your life has gone in vain. You could not do what you had aspired for. Third possibility is that you pursued your studies, you got a job, you earned wealth, you earned more than what your maternal uncle has. You went to insult him and insulted him also the same way, right, as he did. But this was observed by his son, right? Not what will happen. This son will also take up, you know, take an oath the same day that someday I'm going to earn more than this boy and humiliate him. And this chain will continue. So anyway, if you have this kind of desire, this kind of assumption in you that by humiliating your maternal uncle, you are going to be happy, you are going to be in problems, right? So this way you can see, we keep on assuming so many things. And we have movies showing this kind of revenge, right? And the students, when they observe this kind of movie, they also get conditioned in a similar manner. I'll take another example. We had a friend of ours who was working. He was an alumnus from IIT Kanpur and he was working at Bombay and he was working with an MNC. And he was doing well, earning a lot. But one day he read in a newspaper that one of his batchmates, who was not even a higher scorer than him during studies in BTech, had joined on a job somewhere and in US, and he had started his own startup. And this startup was doing so well that his name was listed in this Forbes 500. And then this person started thinking that, okay, I was more meritorious than this boy, and I can do better than this person. So why not go to US, have one's own startup, and then surpass this boy in terms of achievement in life. So with that thought, what he did, he left his job in Bombay. He collected all his assets, took his family. Initially, his wife registered, but he insisted. He took his wife to the US, and then he started working there, and he kept working there for years together. And some years, maybe 7 or 8 years had passed. And one day he read in the news that the person with whom he was competing had met heart attack sitting in the office. Now this person was completely taken aback what to do now, because the person with whom he was competing has met a heart attack. If he goes on a similar path, he's also going to have a heart attack today or tomorrow. So, but still with some exploration, he could see that this is not the right thing to do. He will go back. He has enough, no need for this mad race. So he planned to go back. But then his wife had got settled in US, and when he insisted, now wife registered, right? And his wife said that, I will not go with you. You go to India back. So he came back with his two sons. And by that time, because he was so much engrossed in his business, his elder son had become a drug addict. His younger son also had become a kind of scoundrel. He never spent time in the family or obeyed his father. Then he contacted us because he was known to us somewhere. And then he came with his two sons to the center at Kanpur. He stayed with us. And then his two sons also attended workshop. And in due course of time, things got right to some extent. So you just see, this is an assumption that if a person has been there studying with me during my bachelor's and he was a lower scorer and I am a higher scorer, right, then I should be having more wealth than him. My name should feature, much above him. Now, this is a kind of assumption. And you can see what kind of problems you keep on running into. So if you try to reflect into your own life, you can see that there are so many problems that we have created for ourselves by working on the base of assumption. Isn't it? You just try to reflect. You just try to reflect back on the past 10 years of your life and see what all decisions have you taken, right? And how those decisions have landed up or may have landed up in problems. If the knowing were ensured earlier, then it might not have landed up in this kind of problem. So this is something for us to reflect, try to think over it. So many a times we get preconditioned with these kinds of assumptions. We do not exercise this knowing potential in us, and then the assumptions keep on changing. Today we have one kind of assumption, tomorrow we have another kind of assumption, right? And then the conduct remains indefinite. So the solution is to be resolved. And that is possible only when we have this activity of knowing in us. So this knowing through self-verification on the basis of natural acceptance and on the basis of living accordingly can only make our assumptions definite, which are based on knowing, which can be acceptance. So when I'm able to activate this potential of knowing in me, I'm able to ensure this knowing in me, then only I'm able to come out of this problem domain to the solution domain. I feel resolved. And then my conduct is definite. And certainly would like to come out of it. When we are in the domain of problem, we want to come out of it. And essentially, if you see, if we have to make it a tradition on this earth, the only way is education sanskar. This is the basic role of education sanskar, to take the human being from the problem domain to the domain of resolution. So that we are able to see the things as they are. We know the things as they are. We are able to know our needs. We are able to know our relationships. We are able to know our role in the nature, in the society, and then only our conduct can become definite. So let me take again some reflection from you here. Is it correct to say that our problems are due to assuming without knowing? In the meantime, if there are any questions, I can take. If there are any questions regarding the content that we're discussing right now, so we can please raise hands for that. So Dr. Gomathi, any question regarding the content that we're discussing right now, ma'am? Dr. Gopalakrishnan?
Hello, sir.
Hello, ma'am.
This is Gomathi. So yes, for ma'am. The self as well as body, you are talking about recognition as well as fulfillment, sir.
Ji. No, ma'am. So, recognition and fulfillment only in the body and in the self, sir. Four activities.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Dr. Gopalakrishnan?
Yes, sir. No question, sir. Clearly, you explained the thing between the knowing the problems and again finding the solution for the problem. Explanation is very good, sir.
Okay. Nice, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Tamil Selvi?
Yes, sir. So you talked about knowing, assumption and everything.
Yes, ma'am.
You have given the resolution, sir. So actually, what sort of resolutions we have to take so that we'll get some good understanding, sir? Hello?
Hello, ma'am. Yeah. So, in fact, this is something that we're discussing, what resolution means. So, we'll see that once we are able to self-explore on the basis of natural acceptance, and we are able to validate in our life, then we feel resolved. So, with the resolution, we are able to have harmony in the self. With the resolution, we are free of contradictions in our desires, in our thoughts, conflict in our aspirations. So, that is the state of resolution. So essentially, what is required to be done in the education sanskar also, no, is the process of self-exploration.
Yes, sir. So we have to examine ourselves, sir, to solve the problem, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Dr. Gyanamurthy? Any question? Dr. R.N. Uma? Yeah, Dr. Gyanamurthy.
Sir, how to validate self and our body together?
Okay.
How it is correct or not?
Yeah, so first of all, look at the needs, sir. And then you can see that the two needs are distinct. They are different. Needs of the body are different from needs of the self. Secondly, you can see the activities. The activities of the body are different from activities of the self. Right? Similarly, the responses. Okay. So you can see, we'll come to it now, that body is a material entity while self is a conscious entity. Okay, sir. Yeah. 1 minute, ma'am. There's one hand raised from the panelist. Okay. Dr. Sita Lakshmi. Ma'am, you want to say something here? Dr. Sita Lakshmi. Okay, not able to get to her.
Yeah, can you hear now?
Yes, ma'am, clearly.
The thing is that in your slide, you had mentioned about the mind and body separateness. But in the realm of philosophy, there are various theories as to whether the mind and body are a duality and a binary, or are they a non-duality? So just like we have in our non-dualism in India. So the same way, the body-mind duality is also, we discuss about it a lot. So some people were, there's also some research which talks about how the Indian way of dividing the body and mind started from the, colonial rule, where so when we looked at spirituality as a mind realm and the body as a separate realm. But generally, the body has to be good for us to have a good mind. No? So I want you to elaborate more on this mind-body. Is it a duality or a non-duality according to you?
Okay, ma'am. So let me correct one word. We are using the word self. Right? So the word mind that we have heard of, no, might have different connotations. So first of all, try to see whether you are the body or you are different from the body. Okay. So
oh, okay.
We might have read so many things, but ultimately what is required is to look within, to look at oneself. So find out for yourself whether you are the body or you are different from the body. Whether your needs, you know, whether your needs are the same as those of the body or different from the body.
Okay.
Your activities. Isn't it, ma'am? Then only that process of exploration starts. Otherwise, you may keep on referring to things that we have read, but that exploration doesn't start.
Okay. Yeah, so in that exploration, it's very dynamic. For example, when someone is not well, the body becomes the supreme thing. When someone is well and they have their bodily needs are met with, then we go to the mind. So even a person is not in the same state continuously. So, you know, I understand.
There also you can see, ma'am, there also you can see that even if the body is healthy, we may be unhappy.
Okay.
And even if the body is unhealthy, Anna, and a friend of your close friend or friend of yours comes to see you, you become happy.
Okay. So we have to answer the questions for ourselves.
Yes. You have to address yourself, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, nice. So most of you are able to see that, you know, the problems are due to assuming without knowing. Very nice. So that's why we can see that is a clear need to know the things as they are. Nice. So when you look at the complete thing, we can see that the needs of the self are different from the needs of the body. The activities of the self are different from the activities of the body. The response of the self is also completely different from the response of the body, right? So you can see that a human being is coexistence of two distinct realities. One is the body and the other is self. You know? I am the conscious entity, the body is a material entity. And this consciousness is marked by this activity of knowing and assuming. Now the gross, so we can see the need of the self is continuous happiness, you know, which is the need of the consciousness. And this is fulfilled by right understanding and right feeling in the self, which are the activities of the consciousness. And the need of consciousness is fulfilled by the activities of consciousness only. So this is something to be understood, that my needs are going to be fulfilled by my activities. Similarly, the needs of the body, since the body is a material entity, it is going to be fulfilled only by material things, right? And this we'll discuss that physical facility is required for nurturing, protection, and right utilization of the body, right? So the body is material in nature, its needs are material in nature, and the fulfillment is also material in nature. So one domain is completely material, the other domain is completely consciousness. And the two have to be understood separately, right? No need to assume anything, no need to take as a prescription, just try to look into yourself. Now try to look into your needs, your activities, your responses, and then you can see them distinctly. One gross misunderstanding is that most of the time we assume ourselves to be the body, right? And then what is happening? Since this assumption is wrong, the need of the body, which is physical facility, is assumed to fulfill the need of the self. You know? And since this need of the self for respect is continuous, right? So you try to fulfill this continuous need by having more and more physical facility. In some sense, trying to make that unlimited. And this is what is happening today. People want respect and continuity. But how to ensure it? It is not clear. They are not able to see that respect is going to be ensured only through right understanding. So what they are going for? Again, assuming oneself to be the body, going for accumulating and consuming more and more physical facility and trying to make it unlimited. You know? And you can see what is happening there. So people are accumulating physical facility, you know, trying to make it unlimited. But at the base of it, they have the feeling of deprivation. You can see there are so many people having, you know, thousands of crores, lakhs of crores, right? There are people who are absconding from the country, fugitives, right? Turning into fugitives. And the kind of disrespect that they are getting in the society today, right? While they have worked throughout to accumulate physical facility. But at the base, they have the feeling of deprivation. That's why they have gone for corruption. They have gone for exploitation. Now, we can see the problem here in terms of deprivation, corruption, exploitation. But unless we are able to see the root cause of it, we cannot resolve this problem. We have been trying for a long time to solve the problem of corruption in society, problem of exploitation in society. We have been going for so many movements. We have been going for so many movements to remove this problem from the society. But ultimately, when the human being is not clear about the distinct existence of self and body, then one is going to be caught in this kind of misunderstanding, this kind of assumption. And what is happening here, you get caught up in a loop. So the feeling of deprivation is there in you that you don't have enough, and then you make effort for more physical facility, then you try to accumulate even more, trying to make it unlimited. But since this is not unlimited, it is still having a limit, you try to even work for more, and then the feeling of deprivation continues. And this is something that we can see in the society today. So just a reflection from you would like to have. So are we caught up in this loop? And the loop would mean that we have the feeling of deprivation, right? That I don't have enough. And then we work for more physical facility, trying to make it unlimited, but it is not unlimited. So we try to work for more with the feeling of deprivation, and we got caught up in this loop. In the meantime, I can take one or two questions. I'm picking people from the bottom because they might be asking something directly related to the content being proposed right now. So Dr. L. Mahesh, any question pertaining to this content, sir?
No, I just wanted to know, how do we ensure that we stay aloof?
Aloof?
From being getting into that loop of...
Okay. So you want to come out of the loop.
How do you come out of the loop?
Yes, sir. So that is only possible by understanding the self as it is and the body as it is. So when you are able to see the two realities differently, you are able to see their needs differently, you are able to see their activities distinctly, their responses distinctly, right? Then only you are able to have this kind of understanding in you so that you can come out of the loop.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir. Just wanted to know.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Mahalakshmi. Dr. Jayashree.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Dr. Jayashree here. Yes, sir, now when we were talking of the physical, the body and the self. Okay, mm-hmm. I'll just tell you like what I have understood is right. Body is, self is something which is within the body, which requires much more than what the body requires. The body requires physical facilities, whereas the mind, which is inside, or the consciousness, which is inside our body, requires things that are very continuous, like respect, love. Am I right, sir?
I'll rather correct it, ma'am. So the self is you, right?
Yeah.
And you are with your body, you're not inside the body. So the self or the consciousness is not inside the body.
Okay.
It is with the body. So the body is a material entity. And a conscious entity can never become a subset of material entity.
Okay.
So you are coexisting. So when you say self, in fact, a better word could be I. Or when you refer to yourself. So I am there and the body is there. The body is a material entity. I am a conscious entity. And I am coexisting with my body. And we see further that in this coexistence, I am only exchanging information. For example, when I listen to your question, the information came to me through my ears. And when I'm saying something, I'm again giving some information to my mouth and with which I'm able to speak. So it's such a coherent coexistence that many a times we assume the two to be the same while they are different. So the more we are clear about the distinct existence of the two realities, one being material, the other being conscious, the more clearly we can understand harmony at other levels of living. Fine, ma'am.
And there's one more question, sir, which I would like to ask you. It is on natural acceptance, which we were dealing a little earlier. Actually, when suppose you know that these are my values, these are my things, and I am very clear in my mind what I really want, and then I'm put in a situation which doesn't go along with my values. This doesn't go along with my beliefs or whatever we say is a right understanding about myself.
Mm-hmm.
Then there is always a conflict arising between you adjusting, or then you need to go in with the compromising the situation, right, sir? And how will the national acceptance actually come in?
Ma'am, one possibility is there that you have understood partly but not completely.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, you have tried to understand about yourself, but you are not very much clear about the other self.
Okay.
So one possibility is there. You know? Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it may be the case that we have not understood the things as they are. You know? So, mm-hmm. when we have the complete understanding of harmony at all levels,
mm-hmm.
then we never feel a need to compromise or adjust. Only that we have to participate. We have to decide our role, you know, depending on the situation. And every time I'm able to see my role in terms of harmony. Okay. Never ever do I am I forced to work for disharmony.
Okay. Isn't sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. But the thing is, again, my doubt is, it is right that I have to put myself into harmony. But sometimes situations do come where you cannot be in harmony with that situation because it doesn't go along with what your right understanding is.
Right. Ma'am. So don't what we'll do, ma'am, many a times these situations involve more than one person, isn't it, ma'am? So
yes, exactly. When it comes to more than one person.
Yes, yes. So we talk about the feelings in relationship, no, ma'am. This will become more clear.
Okay, okay, right.
But you can come up with the question in the evening also, we can discuss. But tomorrow when we discuss harmony in the family, this will be more clear to you.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So nice. Many of you are able to see that, you know, we are caught up in this loop and we need to come out of this loop. So to sum up, human being is coexistence of self and body. Self is consciousness. Its needs are feelings in consciousness like happiness. And these needs are fulfilled by the activity of consciousness. And that is right understanding and right feeling. Body is a material entity. Its needs are material like food. And these needs are fulfilled by material, that is physiochemical things. We also saw that the needs of the consciousness cannot be fulfilled by material things. And the needs of material cannot be fulfilled by consciousness alone. Right? So the recognition and fulfillment of the body is definite. The recognition and fulfillment of the self is on the basis of... So the recognition and fulfillment of the self is on the basis of knowing and assuming. So if the assumption is based on knowing, the assumption is right and the recognition and fulfillment is also correct and then the conduct is definite. If the assumption is without knowing, the assumption may or may not be right. So the recognition and fulfillment is uncertain. And then we have indefinite conduct, right? So this is something that we discussed so far. And there is a video on the YouTube. During the break, you can watch this video. This is a 21-minute video. You know? And this will throw light on what all we have been doing in terms of accumulation and consumption in our day-to-day life. Let me discuss briefly the assignment that we have today. So you have to make a list of your desires, right? And you have to find out to which is a given desire directly related out of. Like out of right understanding, relationship and physical facility, how is the desire related? For example, you have desire for money. So if you make out the reason, since we get physical facility from money, so this is something to do with physical facility. Similarly, for example, one may have desire for name and fame, right? Now, as we get the feeling from the other human being, so this is something to do with the relationship. Food, again, if you see, is something in terms of physical facility. Car is a physical facility. Peace of mind is something to do with yourself, which you can get through right understanding, right? So this way you can segregate. So we have to make a list of desires, make a list of at least 20 desires, and then try to segregate them. This will help you study your desires. This will help you study yourself. Another exercise that we can do today, and I'll suggest that all of us need to do this. This may appear a little childish at this stage of our life. Many of us are heads of the institutions or reputed institutions. But once you do this, then you will be able to see that certain basic things might not be clear to us. So these exercises are quite doable. Second thing, what you can do, you have to look into the purpose of the desire and then see whether that purpose relates to the self or the body. For example, if the desire is for money and we are getting money to have physical facilities and this can serve the need of the body. So this is something to do with the body. But if you are going for money to have a status in society, and since the self may have the desire for society, which is status, then this is something to do with the self. Similarly, if you are trying to go for merrymaking, trying to get some sensation, some excitement in the self, then it is something to do with the self. Name and fame is certainly something to do with the self. Good food, if you're trying to have good food for health of the body, then this is something to do with the body. But if you're going for good food for taste, so the taste is going to be enjoyed by you, right? So this is something related to the self. Similarly, if you want a car to save energy of the body in transportation, right? Something to do with the body. But if you try to enjoy respect in the society by moving in that car, it is something to do with the self. Or if you look good sitting in that car, it is something to do with the self. Well, peace of mind is something to do with the self. So this way you can study your desires, segregate them, and then find out what percentage of desire is related to the needs of the self and what percentage is related to the needs of the body. Maybe most of the desires are related to the self and very few to the body. And then again, find out what percentage of effort is spent for physical facility and what effort is spent for right understanding and right feeling. So maybe most of the time we are investing for physical facility and very few moments we are spending for right understanding and right feeling. And we can see the contrast here. These numbers are just a kind of illustration. May not be the same for everybody. We are not saying that this is going to rule everybody. Only that this is to illustrate that many a times most of the time our desires are to do with the self, but we're investing our time, energy for the body, right? For the physical facility. And we can see this contrast. So we can take a reflection here, but it is already 11:30. So what we can do, formally we'll close the session. Those who want to ask certain thing. So maybe our moderators are available. Professor Gajendra is here and he can address you. So this is something that we'll take as a break for now, and we'll assemble back at 12. And then I'll request that please don't log out. Keep yourself logged in, because once you log out, logging in may create a problem again. So don't log out. And in the meantime, if you can spare time, then do watch this video, The Story of Stuff. So I request Gajendra sir to kindly take over.
Okay.
There are some
right, sir.